God say amen.
Praise the Lord. Amen. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. We thank God certainly for all of you who have made your way out today. This is another day, another Lord's Day. At least we call it the Lord's Day. Praise the Lord. We gather here to lift him up and to magnify and to give him glory. I don't know about you, but my week has been full of opportunities to praise the Lord. How about yours? Amen. Amen. We're the people of God. We're going to find an opportunity to give God some praise and glory, for he's worthy to receive it. We are here today because God has been so good. Come on, somebody. Amen. We are here today. Hallelujah. Amen. Because of the goodness of the Lord. And I know I got a testimony. Now I know you got a testimony. The devil is still alive, so everybody got a testimony. If you're in the house of God and if you're saved today, you know that the enemy tried to stop you. Oh, but thank God for Jesus. Hallelujah. Who died for our sins, that we could be in the house of God today, lifting up the name of Jesus. So as we get ready to go forward in our service, our praise team is ready. Amen, our praise team, in Jesus' name.
Amen. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise the Lord, everybody.
Hallelujah.
I said praise the Lord, everyone.
Hallelujah.
I ask that you stand on your feet and give God glory with us. We be able to walk in alone as a testimony. We're chasing after the Lord. Hallelujah.
I'm chasing after you.
I'm chasing. God with us. We've made it through this past week. Amen. Like Elder Howard said, we have so many reasons to give God glory. So we just want to continue to praise his name. We just want to lift his name on high. Amen.
You came to save us, Lord.
Hallelujah. Lord, I lift your name on high. All the things you've done for me. Well, I'm going to move on. Praise the Lord. We're going to have Deacon McDaniels come up, and he's going to lead us to the throne of grace this morning as we make our way through our service.
Amen. Praise the Lord, saints of God. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Our singer said, we will lift your name on high. He showed us the path, but he came from down, he did it. He didn't make a mistake. He made it all the way down, up, through, and he did it. Let's give him a hand clap praise. He showed us the path. He was the prime example for us, the only true example for us, and we praise God for who he is in our lives. Let us go to the throne of grace. We thank God for just this day. We ask that you all stand. Who could stand? Stand. With our heart focused, our mind focused, and our hearts lifted up to Jesus. Father God, here we go. Father, we thank you for another chance. Just another word of praise to you to let you know it's because of you. And it's all about you. And what you're able to do with in and through us. How you choose to use us. We're so glad to be the vessels that you choose to be. Your hands, your feet, your mouth, your ears, your heart, that attentive heart that know and can hear when someone says something don't sound right. We don't question, we just go about doing it. Looking to it, helping, praying, breaking out what needs to be broken down. Doing it that you get the glory of. We want to be that witness for you. We want to be that mouth for you. We want to be that body for you, that arm, that leg for you, because you have done it for us. We thank you for that. We come with you with an open heart, a grateful heart, a thankful heart, a good heart to say thank you. We want to thank you for this. We want to thank you for that. Oh, yeah, and we open up the curtain, and we thank you for that, too, because you did it. You continually do it for us. You woke us up today, closing our mind. First, we laid down in you, but we woke up in you, giving you the glory and giving you all the honor because you did it. You caused us to move to have our full use of our activities because of you. Everything that we say you because of you. You did it. We thank you for all things. We ask that you bless and keep us all covered in your blood. Have your way. Let your will be done in our lives. Lord, we thank you for our apostle and first lady. We want to take the time out to acknowledge them, the visionaries that you have given us. We thank you for them. For what you give them, it flows down to us. We're grateful for everything that you do through them. Bless and keep them covered in your blood. Keep your blood stay now put a hand on their lives, Lord, because they are our visionaries. You give them to us. And we thank you for them. Bless the sick and the shut-in around the world, the bereaved families. You know all about that, Lord. Comfort their heart. Give them that peace that you talk about, that pastor all understand, to let them know that you're right there, sitting right next to them. Encourage their hearts, Lord, as they go through, because there's going to come times when you're going to be saying, they're going to say, oh, if such and such was here, or if how was so, this person do that. But let them know, I'm right here, and I got you. I got your back. Lord, keep us all covered in your blood. Have your way. Let your will be done. We praise you. We glorify you. Then, Lord, think about the saints here at the church, in Statefield, and here in Charlotte. Bless and keep us all covered in your blood. Have your way this day, Lord. Then, Lord, we want to take the time out. We thank you for all that you do, how you provide what you do for us. If you take care of our wants, you do a good job with our wants, too. You said you would supply our needs, but you something else with our wants, too. You handle those things, too. But, Lord, we want to take this time out. I want to take this time to thank you for what you stopped, the things that you stopped, that car accident I could have been in, we could have been in, that bullet that could have came across our way. Yes, Lord, we want to thank you for that one that just, we could have walked down the middle of the street. Something could have happened. You stopped it. So as we thank you for the provisions and all that you do, the navigations that you do, but we want to thank you for what you stopped. You stopped it. You did it for us. And we want to thank you. We don't take it lightly. We want to thank you. We're grateful for what you are doing. Bless and keep us all covered in your blood. Have your way. Let your will be done because we are people that want to be kept. We want to be under your blood. Then, Lord, like the choir was saying, it's something about chase. Yeah, I think about in the Bible, the woman with the issue of blood. She said if you could just touch the hem of his garment. Yeah, she knows she'll be made whole. And I'm with her on that one. But I'm talking about chasing continually after you, staying with you, even after you do what you do. I want to chase you the more. I want more of you, Lord. Have your way this day. Bless and keep us all covered in your blood. Handle all that needs to be handled. Bless our hearts and our minds and our soul, and our spirit may be glorified through you. Have your way this day, Lord, and we give you all the glory and all the honor. Let us all say in Jesus' name. Let's give the Lord a hand clap praise, because we find that he's worthy of it. He is worthy of it. Yes, he is worthy of it in Jesus' name.
Praise the Lord. Thank you, Deacon McDaniel. We appreciate that. Amen. For our scripture reading, we'll move over to we will continue in the book of Acts, Acts chapter 12. If you would turn in your Bibles to Acts chapter 12. We'll start reading at verse 5, and we'll read down through verse 16. Acts chapter 12, verses 5 through 16. While you're standing, we want to remind you that this afternoon, following morning worship, our church picnic will be held at Franklis Park in Concord, North Carolina. Please keep that in your mind, your thoughts, and hopefully you will be able to join us at Franklis Park in Concord immediately following or right after our morning worship. Amen. All right. Acts chapter 12, verses 5 through 16. Follow along with me. I'll be reading from the King James Version. Peter, therefore, was kept in prison, but prayer was made without ceasing of the church unto God for him. And when Herod would have brought him forth the same night, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers bound with two chains, and the keepers before the door kept the prison. And behold, the angel of the Lord came upon him, and a light shined in the prison, and he smote Peter on the side and raised him up, saying, "Arise up quickly." And his chains fell off from his hands. And the angel said unto him, "Gird thyself and bind on thy sandals." And so he did. And he saith unto him, "Cast thy garment about thee and follow me." And he went out and followed him, and wist not that it was true which was done by the angel, but thought he saw a vision. When they were past the first and the second ward, they came unto the iron gate that leadeth unto the city, which opened to them of his own accord. And they went out and passed on through one street, and forthwith the angel departed from him. And when Peter was come to himself, he said, "Now I know of a surety that the Lord has sent his angel and hath delivered me out of the hand of Herod and from all the expectation of the people of the Jews." And when he had considered the thing, he came to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose surname was Mark, where many were gathered together praying. And as Peter knocked at the door of the gate, a damsel came to hearken, named Rhoda. And when she knew Peter's voice, she opened not the gate for gladness, but ran in and told how Peter stood before the gate. And they said unto her, "Thou art mad." But she constantly affirmed that it was even so. Then said they, "It is his angel." But Peter continued knocking. And when they had opened the door and saw him, they were astonished. Amen. We have read Acts chapter 12, verses 5 through 16. The word of the Lord is blessed. Praise the Lord our God. It's offering time in the house of God. It's offering time. It's offering time. Give and it shall be given you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, shall men give unto your bosom. For whatsoever measure that ye meet withal, it shall be measured to you again. It's offering time in the house of God. And we all know our different methods and different ways that we can give. Praise the Lord. Through Venmo, I think Cash App, I don't see them on the phone. There they are. Venmo, Pushpay, that's what it is. And Cash App, praise the Lord. So feel free to use those at your leisure. I ask at this time if you would stand on your feet, please. And our ushers will start our directions from the rear, and they will bring us up to our time of offering in Jesus' name. Thank you. is the Lord. Father, we thank you for those who have given. We thank you for this time of offering. We thank you, Father, first of all, let's back up, Lord, for what you have given unto us. You have provided so much for us, given us so much, so many things, so many blessings, so many acts of your kindness. Thank you for it, Father. Now we ask that you would receive our offerings, that we have given back to you a portion of that which you have given unto us. Lord, bless it to be used for the upbuilding of your kingdom and the tearing down the strongholds of Satan. We ask these things in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. At this time, we'll have a special presentation from Mother Parson.
Praise the Lord, saints. Praise the Lord again. How are you doing this morning? Amen. We bless the Lord on this morning, and we give honor to our pastor, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and to our pastor, and to all of the elders and ministers, and all our sisters and brothers in Jesus Christ, and special honor always to our mothers. We love you in Jesus' mighty name. And today, though, we want to honor a special group of women that and young ladies that you probably have no idea what they're doing. Some of you do. Some of you get up at 5 o'clock in the morning, and you are on the line with us, and these women are praying, I mean, like, really praying for you. So if you think in your mind that nobody is praying for you, I want you to know that there is a group of women from right here in the Living Church that are praying for you every single morning. Monday through Friday, 5 a.m. in the morning, some of you are turning over. Some of you don't even have a thought of turning over. And some of you are up getting ready for work. But yet and still, somebody is praying for you. And I remember years ago when the songwriter said, somebody is praying for me. And when I went through some of my most difficult times, I remember that somebody somewhere was praying for me. So I'm going to ask all the young women that get up in the morning, and I'm talking about the ones that actually pray, because I know some of you say, I get up and I pray, but I mean, actually verbally speak on the line, to come up here, all of you, come up here, young, old, middle-aged, I want you all to come, all of you to come. That's right. Keep on clapping. Y'all didn't know they were doing this, did you? Keep on clapping. And I want you to know that these are not all of them, because we have two, if I'm not mistaken, that's away in college, and our two babies, they must be in Statesville. We have two younger ones that's right here, and they're in Statesville. We're getting ready to add another young one on. Y'all don't know yet, but we getting ready to add another young one. She's younger than the youngest one, all right, because she prayed yesterday morning. Where she is? Is she here? Where is she at? Zuri, can you come up here? The Lord blessed us on yesterday morning. Today actually is the anniversary. 12 years ago, started a 5 a.m. prayer line. And I want you to know there is some of them that's here that's actually been on 12 years. We're missing another one too. Peggy is not here. Now, Sister Marilyn, I just want you to step forward, because of the ones that was the 12-year ones. 12 years ago, it was myself, it was Sister Marilyn and Sister Peggy Fuller and a couple of others that are not here today. One of them has actually gone on to be with the Lord. But we got on the prayer line 5 days a week, and we were praying. And as the Lord was so gracious and so good to us, he started adding to it. So then Mother Brown, step out, Mother Brown. Mother Brown joined the prayer line in probably less than a year of us starting, and she's been praying ever since. And then we had Mother Gunning, who is not here. She was on the prayer line, and we had, y'all can help me out if I mess up somebody. Sister Peggy, as I said, was on the prayer line, and Mother Stark started out when Mother Gunning got sick. Now, some of you did not know Mother Gunning was one of our faithful prayer warriors, and she ended up in church having a stroke, not here, but in Statesville. And she was a profound prayer warrior, but Mother Stark stepped right in and helped us out. Step out, Mother Stark. And she's been praying ever since. The Lord has been really, really good to us, because I've seen a dynamic growth in every last one of them. And one, two, that's three that's not here also is Sister Shamika Thornton, and we're going to go to Statesville and do this with them, and her two daughters. They are two others that is a part of this group. But I want you to know something. These prayer daughters, as we call them, step out, prayer daughter, step out. Come on, give them a... That's right, step out. Step out. Oh, my goodness. Sometime I am on that prayer line on Thursday morning. What we institute on Thursday morning is that the prayer daughters will start off praying, and then Sister Shamika, Lady Shamika, would take the mic from where they let off. Now, sometimes they don't want to let off, you know. But I told them they didn't have to. So they, you know, as long as they want to pray, they can pray as long as they want to. But I'm telling you, the Lord has blessed them. They have increased in their prayers. I will take them anywhere to pray for me and pray with me. Praise the name of God. God has blessed them tremendously. I love each and every one of them in Jesus' mighty name. And I wanted you to know that they don't mind. They get up. I mean, I'm sure some of them are sleepy. But they get up on Thursday morning. And they pray and they call on the name of the Lord. And you know what? They're calling your names out. They're calling your names out in Jesus' name. And I thank God for you. I have gifts for all of you, but we're going to give the gifts after service. All right. But I just have to say this. This little one yesterday, we asked her to pray yesterday. And when I listened to her pray, I said, oh, my goodness. I think she's been listening to her big sister and listening to her mommy and daddy, because she prayed for some of everybody. She prayed for this church. I want y'all to know. She prayed for you on yesterday morning, and I'm so proud of her. And I said, you are added to the prayer line. So on Thursday morning, and I'm going to make sure I tell Alana, who is over the prayer daughters, I'm going to make sure I tell her to add her to the schedule. Because there is a schedule for them that they get up and they pray. I want to also mention to you that on Monday, Mother Brown prays. She prays on Monday. And now on Monday, Mother Brown and Mother Stark, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And I tell you, I know heaven is touched and moved, and so are everyone that is on the line, and God allowed them to pray for all of you. And I'm telling you, there's people getting on this line from all over, and not only in the United States of America, but they're getting on this line and they're praying with us. And on Wednesday, I think it's Tuesday, Dr. Fuller prays. Dr. Fuller get on and she cry out to the Lord for the saints, for the people of God, And you know what? Since Dr. Fuller been praying on the prayer line, her sisters are all on the prayer line. Isn't God good? And I got another surprise. This year they went to the International Convention of the Church of our Lord Jesus Christ. Isn't that awesome? Praise the Lord. We thank God for that. And then on Wednesday, I give my little prayer and I, you know, get finished and I sit down, you know. Praise the Lord. And I tell you, I'm grateful to God because with all the traveling that we have been doing and we're in and out, these are some faithful women. Most of the time, Mother Brown steps in. Sister Peggy has stepped in. Sister Marilyn, different ones have stepped in and prayed when I could not be there to pray. And I thank God for them. And at the same token, on Thursday now, Shamika, she just bring down the house. She cries out to the Lord. She prays. She seeks the Lord. And she's calling out everybody's name here and far. And I just thank God for her because she joined the prayer line. I think she actually just joined the prayer line about 2 or 3 years ago. And she's been praying and praying and praying. And then on Friday, Marilyn had folks shouting in their homes. She had folks shouting in their homes. And I mean, like, she's not praying. That's Thankful Friday. That's the Friday. We spend all week long asking the Lord for something. We spend all week long seeking the Lord and supplicating before him. Hallelujah. And then on Friday, we have designated to say, I want to say thank you, Lord. I just want to say thank you. I want to say thank you how you woke me up. I want to say thank you how you touched my body. I want to say thank you how you ministered to me. I want to say thank you. Oh, God, hallelujah. Hallelujah. And songs are played, and people are thanking the Lord from all over. And God is healing bodies and delivering folks. And it goes on for a whole hour. A whole hour. And sometimes we can't get off the line. Sometimes folks don't want to let us go. They want to stay on for another hour. So, this past Friday, we gave them 2 hours. This past Friday in celebration, we allow people who have been so faithful, that's been getting on the line from New York, from Florida, from Georgia, we allow them to have an opportunity to take part in doing what we do every day. We allow them to take part in it, and God blessed us. For 2 hours, and Pastor left us with a word. And the word that he left us with had to do with the number what? Exactly. Exactly. So we just want to say to you, there are people that are praying for you. And I want you to pray for them. When you get in your prayer closet, when you get down on your knees, call their names out. Call their names out before the Lord because they're laboring before the Lord, for you and your family. There's not one family that is in this church that have not been called out on the prayer line. Oh, what are you doing over there? This is my backup. Sister Wanda, whenever I can't be here, and if I don't call Mother Brown or let Mother Brown know, and sometimes I can't call Mother Brown, let Mother Brown know, but if she don't hear anyone by, what is it, 4:56? If she doesn't hear Wanda or me by 4:56, Mother Brown starts praying. Praise the Lord. So we want to say thank you in Jesus' name. God bless you all, and keep praying for us as we will continue to pray for you.
Shall do for me. remain standing. Wise and eternal God, we thank you, Lord, for your goodness. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you, Lord, for kindness. Thank you for this day that you have given us. Lord, we bless your name today. We always worship you, and we give you the glory and the honor. Now, Lord, bless this word that you have put in our spirits for your people. Lord, we ask you to allow us to decrease and bless and make a blessing in the matchless name, Jesus Christ, we pray. Let us all say amen and amen. God bless you. You may be seated. We do honor the spirit of Christ today, who is the head of the church. Thank God for all of you, all of our visiting friends and loved ones, if you're in the building today. Truly the Lord is good. Thank God for this weekend of celebration of 12 years of our prayer warriors on the prayer line. Special time to celebrate them and recognize their labor of love. As we continue in our study of the book of Acts from various scriptures, and on the week before last week, we talked about such as I have versus how much I have, and the lust that we all have. And on last week, we continue with Stephen's sermon and talking about the connection between history, knowing and appreciating history, and living in victory today, and taking the mystery out of tomorrow. The connection between history, victory, and living without mystery. Today, we want to continue and in celebration even of our 12 years of prayer and prayer line that we had a chance to celebrate with them on yesterday. We're going to focus our attention on Acts, the 12th chapter, verse 5 through 16. You have heard this read in your hearing, but I will mention just verse 5. You follow along with us, and you can say amen if you still have it. Acts 12, verse 5 says, Peter, therefore, was kept in prison, but prayer was made without ceasing of the church unto God for him. And verse 11, when he is finally out of the bondage of the prison, as the church is praying, and Luke is very intentional in tying he was kept in prison, but prayer was made without ceasing. He makes the connection between his time in prison and prayer being made without ceasing. Verse 12, and when he had considered the thing, he came to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose surname was Mark, when many were gathered together praying. Once again, Luke wants you to know that they continue to pray all the time that Peter was locked up. And as Peter knocked on the door of the gate, a damsel came to hearken named Rhoda. I'm going to just stop right there. You've heard this in your hearing, but I want to speak to you briefly for just a few minutes, as this is our day that we really want you to fellowship and just meet with the saints and encourage each other in our outing and our picnic on today. I want to speak to you from the subject. Just look at somebody and give them a smile. Amen. I want you to tell them, neighbor, let's pray for a prison break. Hallelujah. Just reach over and tell them again, tonight we break out. Let's pray for a prison break. Of course, you know, this time the persecution of the church was increasing, and James was killed, Herod, and Peter was put in prison. Now, we're not told for how long, but all the time he was in prison, we're told that the church was praying for his release. And the night or the night before the time Herod was going to bring Peter out, God sent an angel to break Peter out of prison. And in honoring this 12-year celebration of the prayer line, I want to give you at least three things about the importance of fervent prayer. The combination without ceasing also means fervent, fervent, intensely, continuously. Number one, fervent prayer is praying the written word of God. Everybody say, let's pray the written word of God. At the very minimum, prayer is honoring and praying the written word of God. As we noted in Acts, early in Acts 4, those who were full of the Holy Spirit, they prayed the word. And prayer is communication with God, and it shows how much you love him, how much we love him. Jesus says in John 14 and 15, if you love me, keep my commandments. In that statement, he summarized what God has been saying since the Genesis in the Bible. The way you confirm that you love God is not how much you read the Bible, not how often you are in church or what you are doing in church, not how much you speak in tongues, not how much we celebrate and praise God and jerk and shake under the alleged anointing. Those who love God will affirm they love God by obeying his word. I could tell my wife I love her all day long, but my walk towards her has to be consistent with my talk to her. Coming to the church building every week is wonderful. We love you. We want to see you, but that does not say how much you love God. Just like me coming home from work every day does not necessarily mean I love my wife. You know, if you say you love God, then confirm it by obeying the word of God, which is the will of God. Praying the word of God is critical, saints, because when we communicate with God by praying, it's our willingness to obey his will and do what God said for us to do. It is critical. It's our willingness. John 5, 14 through 15, or 1 John. In fact, our willingness to obey and do God's will, saint, that makes prayer not only meaningful, but effective. When you have in your mind, Lord, I want to do your will. I want to do what you want me to do. I want to do what's right. I want to be consistent with your word. 1 John 5, 14 and 15. You have to get it, write it down. 1 John 5, 14 and 15. And this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petition that we desired of him. I want you to notice here, prayer is communication with God about his will, not dictation to God about our temporary thrills. I'll say that again. It's about communicating about his will, not dictating to him about our desires. In fact, the only confidence that we really have that our prayers are answered yes is when God's will is our priority and our focus and our mind is on, Lord, I want to do your will. I want to know what you have said for me. We all come here for a purpose, a God-given purpose. And we have to know what that is. It begins with parents training up a child in the way they should go. And you came here with the purpose. If you're supposed to be a scientist, you came here with the purpose to be a scientist. If you were supposed to be a prophet or a preacher, you came here with that purpose. The challenge is, if you came here to be a football player who was going to make a touchdown in the Super Bowl and kneel down in front of millions of people and pray, you came here with that purpose. Parents are to fulfill the challenge of knowing what that purpose is. And God, so praying in order for all ways to guarantee a yes in prayer is to approach prayer with the will of God as your priority. Let me remind you, God answers prayer how many ways? At least four different ways. God will say no. He will take it slow. God will say grow some more. Or he'll say go. But God doesn't always answer yes, saints. And so you don't want to answer your own prayers. Tell somebody, don't answer your own prayers. God, I want what you want. But more importantly, I want what you want for me. Because in the short term and the long term, God's will is what's best for me. And when we pray the will of God, we pray the confidence so we don't have to answer. We don't have to wait for the answer to believe God. We can have the answer we so desire when we are praying. And listen, saints, if you do not know the specific will of God, it is better to err on the side of caution, as the expression says. Jesus is our example of how to at least use caution when you have a desire, but that desire may or may not be consistent with the will of God. Recorded in the Gospels, Jesus praying when he is only a few hours from laying down his life by submitting to the most painful, the most humiliating, the most horrendous form of death that was known to man, death by crucifixion. Luke 22, 41 through 44, Jesus praying, he's sweating blood. He's under so much intense anxiety. And he was withdrawn from them about a stone's throw, and he knelt down and prayed, saying, Father, if it is your will, take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. Then an angel, the Bible said, appeared to him from heaven, strengthening him. He was under the pressure of mental anxiety and anguish and emotional frustration. Jesus was not looking forward to going to the cross. God was in that flesh, but when that flesh kicked in, anticipating the pain, he wanted to get out of it. And the Bible said, being in agony, he prayed more earnestly, knowing that God's will was for him to go through this. Then his sweat began to, like great drops of blood falling down to the ground. And there is a known medical condition where anxiety can be so great that blood can begin to seep through the pores. Oh, we don't like to think about Jesus that way. But if he was touched with the feeling of all the infirmities like you and I, he experienced everything that you and I experience. As the expression goes, Jesus erred on the side of caution. This is the word, nevertheless. Everybody say, nevertheless. Not my will. Hallelujah. Listen. But yours be done. The best for all of us is for God's will to be done. The less for all of us is to choose our own will when it's in conflict with the will of God. Jesus says, nevertheless, look at somebody and tell them, nevertheless. You want the best. Nevertheless. The best is what God wants for you, not what you want for yourself. As for a specific purpose for you, it begins with loving God by obeying the word, the will of God. Romans 8:28 says, all things, not some things, work together for the good of them that love the Lord. Just a saying, but making a change was not the will of God for Jesus. He wanted a change, but God, he came here for that purpose. Jesus came to the earth to be the sacrificial lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. And like all of us, Jesus had a purpose for being on this earth. His purpose for being born was to die for the sins of the world. You have a purpose to be here on this earth. You may be supposed to be an ambassador to the nations. You may even supposed to be the vice, the president. Who knows? God knows. You are here for a purpose. And Jesus knew that settling for anything less would have been catastrophic for the world. So he settled for God's best for him to go through the pain. Too often people settle for the less, saints, and that the will of God, and when it turns out catastrophic, they want to blame it on God. Look at somebody and tell them, don't blame God. Bless God by obeying him. Because at the end of the day, all things are possible with God. Hey, listen, it's possible to get what you want from God and it not be what God wants for you. Jesus could have satisfied his flesh that was dreading the coming pain and not went to the cross. And it would have been the end of it. I mean, there were 12 legions, 72,000 plus angels just waiting for Jesus to give the word.
and he was going to shut it down. Jesus could have gave the word, and them angels would have came down, and it would have been catastrophic. Listen, saints, one angel in the book of Isaiah, I think it was 184,000 Assyrian soldiers, that one angel took out in one night. Jesus had 12 legion plus waiting for him to give them the word that says, I'm done with this. But thank God he went through with it. Can somebody say thank you? Because he went through with the will of God. You are here and I are standing here serving God and blessing God and have a bright, victorious present and a victorious future because Jesus succumbed to the will of God. I finally, about this will of God, praying to assure the will of God is done in your life is the top priority when it comes to prayer, saints. Too many believers under flesh pressure think that if they did take something to God, it means that God gave them the okay to proceed with what they want. Prayer is communication with God about his will for you, not a dictation for God of what you want him to do for you. Listen to me, saints. If you prayed about it, before you proceed, make sure you heard that God, what God had to say about it. Somebody told me one time, I don't want to hear what God said. I back up and made sure that lightning bolt didn't hit me. The Bible said, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. The word helped me understand where I'm at and helped me to navigate where I'm going. Can somebody say the word of God? Fervent prayer is praying the word. The second thing, fervent prayer is work. Fervent prayer is work. Somebody said it's labor. Colossians 4 and 12, write it down, is listing some of his fellow workers he mentioned, the Apostle Paul. He mentions Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ. Salute you. Always laboring fervently for you in prayers, that you may stand perfect and complete in all the will of God. Look at that is again. That you may stand complete in all the will of God. The compound expression, laboring fervently, is from the Greek root word where we get the word agonizing. The word is agon, agonizing. And as we saw Jesus agonizing in prayer, to labor fervently is to struggle in prayer, as if you are competing for a prize. Figuratively, it's as if you are contending with an adversary like the devil himself to endeavor to strive, to accomplish something, to fight for a victory. That's what it means to labor fervently. Fervent prayer encompasses all of these, especially when it comes to intercessory prayer. Oh God, which is the foundational focus of our 5 o'clock prayer line. A designated prayer warriors rise early to struggle and strive for the needs of others to be met, while contending against their flesh that is weak and an adversary that is strong-willed to block those prayers from getting through to God. Fervent prayer is the expenditure of physical, mental, and emotional energy. Yes, prayer is work. But not only is prayer work where there's a physical, mental, and emotional exertion of our flesh, of work and energy. Number three, also fervent prayer is worship. Come out and say worship. Ephesians 6 and 18, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit and watching thereunto, watching, everybody say watching, with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. Here Paul shows that the work of prayer involves an act of worship to God. To supplicate is to prostrate before God in a loss of total vitality, to stand in the flesh while persistently petitioning God in the spirit for the deliverance of others. God, that's why we call them prayer warriors. 5 o'clock every day of the week, they rise up early and deny their flesh the desire to keep sleeping in order to hear prayers required. And then they labor fervently in an effort to reach God in the spirit. So you can't just get in the spirit just because you woke up. You got to work and labor to get to the place where you can even connect with God. To supplicate is to worship God. God. As Jesus told the young Samaritan woman who was in a relationship that was going nowhere in John 4 and 24, God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. This means that each week these prayer warriors have to rise early and first prepare to prostrate their flesh in order to pray in the spirit for God to do something in the natural. Lord, I thank you for prayer warriors. This type of persistence requires being full of the Holy Spirit in order to taste discipline with a determination to see someone delivered. How many is determined to see somebody delivered? Tell the Lord thank you. Prayer worship requires having a love for God. And the work of prayer requires the love of God. See, it's one thing to have a love for God, but you're going to be praying for other people and denying yourself. You got to have the love of God. Both the love for God and the love of God is the work of the Holy Spirit down within our hearts. They are not doing this to be seen, heard, or to get a pat on the back. Neither was it begun due to the pandemic. But long before the pandemic, there was an epidemic of demonic oppression. And God laid this ministry on the heart of First Lady Parson. Oh God, so many people started during the pandemic. But how many know it's blessed when God taps you on the shoulder? And it ain't because everybody else is running scared praying. But God taps you on the shoulders because something is coming in the future, and he's driving you to pray right now. Can somebody say, thank God for the Holy Ghost? There was an oppression of people who had needs. Romans 5, 1 through 5 explains it. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into the place called grace wherein we stand. Not only do we glory in that, but we glory in tribulation. Tribulation works patience, and patience works experience, and experience leads to hope, and hope leaves not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost. How many know you got to have the love of God to wake up at 4 o'clock, find some music, discipline to go to bed early so you can rise early, and then intercede and labor in prayer until worship takes over? And honey, when worship takes over, the devil is cooked then. When worship takes over, something's going to happen then. When worship takes over, but it's work to get yourself into a place. Oh, yes. No, saints, none of this now lay me down to sleep, my soldier, keep and then get up. None of this, God is good, God is great, God is whatever we used to say. But no, that's getting down there laboring, having others on your heart, having others on your mind. And the Bible lets us know that being full of faith and the Holy Spirit, they are rising early each day of the week to work their way into a spiritual stance while watching their flesh. The word translated watch in Ephesians 6 and 18 means to stay awake. They have to stay awake physically, but more importantly, because we have an adversary who does not want their prayers to get through and for your loved ones to be delivered, they have to stay awake spiritually. They have to watch out for all that is in the world. As 1 John 2 and 16 says, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. Let me explain. These warriors are celebrated by those who would have been casualties of spiritual war. I've heard so many testimonies of how God saved, delivered, and healed because somebody was praying on the prayer line. Somebody prayed saved from them. God changed the outcome. Some have been saved, healed, delivered, and returned to health, gotten wealth to relationships, and the list continues. 12 years of so many victorious testimonies. These prayer warriors have to watch. They have to stay awake spiritually so that pride does not set in and cause them to lose the focus. In this world, they have to watch out for the lust of the flesh to stay up late and sleep longer than they should. Their time to go to war. They have to fight the lust of the eyes. Look for somebody to pat them on the back. Look for somebody to celebrate them. Even the temptation to be lifted up in pride after hearing how their prayers made a difference in the lives of others. How many know the devil wants you to stick your chest out so that God can cut off your blessing? But touch somebody and tell them, neighbor, I'm protecting my anointing. Oh God, I praise you. Lord, have mercy. Yes, they are working and worshiping, but it is God who gets all the glory. For all the things that he has done, they have to always be watching, because it's God that gets the glory for 12 years of victory, 12 years of people being delivered. To God be the glory. So what they did to assure that God gets the glory, each Friday for 12 years, they closed the week out with prayer and thanksgiving for the things that God keeps doing. Look at somebody and tell them, God is still doing something. There are prayer songs and testimonies about the things that the Lord keep doing through prayer, because this is the Lord's doing that is marvelous in our eyes. So many people have deemed the prayer line their lifeline, because these prayer warriors keep getting up each day and going behind enemy lines and snatching souls from the grips of hell. Oh God, every morning they make a prayer line for some folks who were thinking about calling the socket hotline, but they heard about prayer and they realized that you don't get advice from a demon, you cast out a devil. Lord have mercy. Folk who wanted to believe their horoscope, hallelujah, got on the prayer line and the horoscope got out of their lives. I wish somebody in here who wants to be a prayer warrior and who is a prayer warrior, and says, tell the devil right now, you better watch out, because my prayers are coming. Can somebody tell the Lord thank you? Worship to God, who is a recipient of all prayer. It blesses and encourages others to pray. But we do not pray to be heard by others. We pray to be heard by God, because he is the rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Prayer is work. Prayer is worship. Prayer is praying the word. What it means to be a prayer warrior is to work in prayer, worship in prayer, and pray the word in prayer. Are there any prayer warriors in here? Tell the Lord thank you. Hallelujah. There are people praying all over the place, but not everyone praying is a prayer warrior. A prayer warrior is a military saint whose prayer is communication with God, not dictation to God, telling God what he got to do for them. Communication that is work and worship, that is consistent with the written word of God. A prayer warrior works to reach God so that they can offer worship up to God that is consistent with the word of God. No matter who you are in God, if you pray the word, do the work of prayer. Oh God, until the prayer becomes worship to God, it will take the worry out of life. How many in here want to live a worry-free life? Let me tell you how it's done. Philippians 4:6 said, don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God all your needs. And don't forget to thank him for the answer. If you do this, you will experience God's peace, which is far more wonderful than the human mind can understand. His peace will keep your thoughts and your hearts quiet, and the rest as you trust in Christ Jesus. Eliminating worrying, living frustrated, making bad decisions, keeping toxic people and relationships out of your life, not being gullible and vulnerable about your weak flesh has to be intentional. You have to pray about everything and worry about nothing, and then thank God for being God. Let's just pause and thank God for being God. Let's just pause. Lord, I don't need nothing. I don't want nothing extra. I was just thinking about everything you've done for me, and I just want to thank you for being God. So in our scripture lesson, Luke is making a connection with Peter's prison break and the saints' prayer break. These prayer warriors prayed Peter out of prison. Peter wasn't worried. He was laying there asleep, but they were still praying. It had got into the night. All these prayer warriors, they had one prayer daughter named Rhoda. At this time, Rhoda was watching while the prayer warriors were praying. I have no doubt that Zuri has been watching her mom, watching Grandma P, and watching all of these prayer warriors pray. Because when Zuri opened her mouth yesterday, I had to open one of my eyes and look to make sure that it was Zuri that was actually praying. The girl prays like a seasoned prayer warrior. How many know that if these little children can dance and sing Daddy Love Baby, if they can sing Hallelujah and dance and do the moonwalk, they ought to be able to walk through the Word of God and pray for the power of the Holy Ghost. There ain't no prayer like a child's prayer. Lord, I praise you. You better tell a child, pray for me. Lord, have mercy. So look at Peter. He ain't worried. He's sleeping. The church is still praying. And while they're praying, God timed his release. God timed his prison break. I don't know how many days they were praying, but they were praying continuously. But God planned the prison break. You sitting in here saved, but I want to tell you, your prison break was a plan. Your prison break was a plan that God set up. God made somebody pray for you so the drugs wouldn't be the same, so the alcohol wouldn't take you the same. You were drinking more than Cooter Brown. You were hung out on Jack Daniel, but your mama was still praying. Your grandmama died praying for you. Don't be mistaken. You are a product of prayer. Just let me talk to the folks who want to tell the truth and not just shame the devil. If you are like me, a product of prayer, lift your hand to mine and tell him I'm a product of prayer. Lord, I praise you. Peter, they're praying, and their prayer caused God to dispatch an angel. They kept praying. The angel came down, a light. He had a divine flashlight in a dark prison dungeon. He shined the light. Peter was so asleep, he had to shake Peter. The church was praying. Peter woke up. The church was still praying. They prayed him out of his sleep. Hallelujah. He got up. And the angel said, put on your clothes. Get yourself together. The church was still praying. He told Peter to get up. The church was praying. They went past one cage of prisoners. The church was still praying. Prayed them by the last cage of prisoners. They were still praying. Went through locked bars and the chains just dropped off. They went through the doors and the door wasn't even unlocked. How many know that your prayers will get somebody out of places that the judge don't have to sign up for, that the lawyer couldn't help them get out of? Your prayer can get people out of places that have the doctor scratching his head, have lawyers scratching their head. Your prayers can make a difference when nothing else can. Your prayer can make a difference when your money and your honey can't help you. But I'm here to let the devil know that Peter was so shocked he thought he was dreaming. How many had a deliverance that had you thinking you were dreaming? Lord, I praise you. Well, let me talk about myself. When I had a kidney infection and the doctor said you were supposed to be dead, but I thought about how my mama used to say, when you were born, I gave you back to God, and I prayed for you. How many know that prayer made the difference? Whenever stuff's supposed to kill you, your sickness is supposed to kill you. Why are you sitting there worrying about cancer? Somebody is praying for you. Can say, somebody is praying for me. Lord, I praise you. They kept on praying until Peter walked out the door. And when Peter walked out the door, the angel took an exit. But the church kept on praying. They kept on praying until Peter made his way through the night, got to the door. They were still praying. A little prayer warrior named Rhoda heard the knock. She recognized Peter's voice. That means she had been hearing him, listening to him. And she said, Peter is at the door. They said, you must have lost your mind. She said, no, I saw him. He's at the door. They said, girl, you don't know what you're talking about. If you're going to pray, believe that God is going to answer you. If you're going to pray, don't be shocked. Don't be astonished. She said, I'll tell you, he's at the door. Lord, I praise you. They went to the door. Lord, my God, I wasn't there, but I feel a praise 2,000 years later about to come out. I want to tell you, church, let's pray for a praise break. Our politicians, they are bound by lobbyists, special interest groups, distortion, distraction, and delusion. They are jailed by their own politics. Let's pray for a prison break. Our social workers, our justice system is in bondage to money. Those who got the money can be cosmic criminals and still get off. Let's pray for a prison break. Let's pray unto these corrupt judges that's on the Supreme Court and your local court. Let's keep praying unto some spirit-filled lawyers. Get in the courthouses. Let's keep praying until justice returns. Let's keep praying. Tell somebody, say, let's pray for a prison break. Our schools at every level are jailed by perverted, perverted folk with license to teach our children about stuff that's robbing their innocence. Let's pray for a prison break. Let's pray that the prison break out on the school board. Let's pray until churches rise up. Let's pray until you rise up and say no more. Let's pray until you get a heart for our children. I didn't learn about sex until it was time. Now they're robbing our babies who were in kindergarten, taking history books out of the schools. Let's pray until some of these corrupt governors get voted out of position. Let's keep praying until some legislators get voted out of position. Let's keep praying until God clean house in the Congress. Let's keep praying. Let's pray for a prison break. Let's pray for a prison break. Not only that, time won't permit to let me tell you, there are good doctors who are in enslaved to being professional drug pushers. The bad lawyers are being celebrated, and the good doctors are being aggravated. Let's pray until all those doctors who don't mean you no good get out of your life. Let's pray until you get some natural solutions for all of your problems. Let's pray until God teaches you how to take care of your own body. Let's pray until you learn how to touch your own self and say, in the name of Jesus, be healed. In fact, let's pause for a moment and have a healing moment. I want you to touch yourself wherever you might need to and say, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, be healed. Now go ahead and praise him like you're crazy. Go ahead and praise him like you got it. I'm praying for a prison break. I'm praying for a prison break. I'm praying for a prison break in my family where the devil got them thinking you're not a parson, you are something else. But let's pray until your children remember where God brought them from. Let's pray until they break out of the bondage of alcohol, dope, lesbianism, homosexuality, lesbianism, gayism, LGBTQ, SRV, whatever they got now. Let's just keep praying until the Lord deliver them. Keep on praying. Keep on praying. Grab somebody by the hand. Yeah, don't take nobody but me and you. One can chase a thousand. Oh God, tell them, neighbor, don't take nobody but you and me. Let's pray for a prison break. Let's pray for a prison break. I believe I will. Anybody praying for a prison break, tell the Lord, thank you. Pastor Parson, what are you doing? I'm praying for a prison break. I need a few prayer warriors to get in the aisle for a minute because I feel the Lord saying I need us to pray for a prison break. Right now, just kneel by your pew. Kneel wherever you can find. Don't talk about yourself. Don't pray for yourself because this prison break is a process. This prison break is a process. You might not see it right away, but if it was a process for Peter, he had the shackles had to fall off. The chain had to fall off. He had to walk through the doors, walk through the cages before he walked out of prison. I hear the Holy Ghost saying, somebody right now is about to be broken out of prison. Keep on praying. Keep on praying. The drugs don't taste the same. Keep on praying. They're going to throw away the cigarettes. Keep on praying until they throw away the alcohol. Keep on praying until they release those friends. Keep on praying. I'm praying for a prison break. Anybody praying? Anybody praying? I want everybody in this building just for the next minute. Let's pray for a prison break. You know somebody who's in bondage, somebody who is bound, somebody who is locked down in the chains of the devil, in the chains of hell. Pray for a prison break. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Bring him out, Jesus. Bring her out, Jesus. Bring them out, Jesus. Save, Lord. Save, Lord. Save, Lord. Take the taste away. They're in prison, facing 5 years. But you are God. We need a miracle. God, we need a miracle. The doctor has given up. The doctor has thrown in the towel. We are praying for a prison break. Lord, you say the Spirit is upon me. He have anointed me to preach the gospel, to set the captive free, and bring deliverance to the bondage. Let's pray. Let's pray. Let's pray. I'm praying for a prison break. Hallelujah. My. Oh, God. I feel a prison break happening. I don't see Peter yet, but I know it's happening. I know he's coming. I know she's coming. I know them tumors are shrinking. I know those friends are leaving. I know that toxicity is leaving. I feel a prison break happening. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Though the storm keep on raging in my life, and sometimes it's hard till the night dead, still that hope that lies within me reassures. Thank you, Jesus. As I keep my eye upon the tears, sure I know he'll lead me safely to that blessed place he has prepared. Hallelujah. But if the storm don't Hallelujah, hallelujah. Somebody's coming through the first cage. Somebody's already at the second cage. Don't worry, those chains have already fallen off. Keep praying, keep praying, keep praying. Hey, glory. I just feel some chains breaking. Loose my pain. Loose the chain. Lord, hear our prayer. If the storm don't cease, and if the wind keeps on blowing in my life, my soul anchored in the Lord. Hallelujah. Oh God. Something about praying for a prison break. You don't ever end it. You just take a pause until the next time. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. And you don't even take a break for the weekend. You don't get on the line. But early in the morning, you're still praying, because something about a prayer warrior is they're going to keep praying for a prison break until they see Peter coming through the door. They're going to keep praying for a prison break until the doctor says, I made a mistake. They're going to keep praying for a prison break until that child that says, I ain't going to talk to you no more, mama, calls them on the phone. They're going to keep praying for a prison break until saints get serious about God. They're going to keep praying. So many churches, people are in bondage to authoritarianism, corrupt leadership, false prophets. Keep on praying. Pray until the false prophets get out of the pulpit. Keep praying until the authoritarians get out of the pulpit. Keep praying until the sheep are the concern of the shepherds. Keep praying. Keep praying. We got to pray for a prison break. Jesus said, I came to set the captive free. He didn't come to fill our pocketbooks. He didn't come to make us celebrities. He didn't come to make us all stars and fallen stars. He came to set the captive free. Thank you for praying for a prison break. I want you to just to get up right now. We're just taking a pause. We're not ending it. I want you to get up. And there's no, you don't pray for a prison break without giving God thanks. And then just everybody around you. Everybody around you. Everybody around you. Everybody around you. Hallelujah. Oh, yeah. I want you to tell somebody, I don't know who it is, even if they're not here, I want you to call them on the phone. You don't have to explain it. Just tell them, tonight you break out. And then you keep praying for them. Nothing is impossible with God. I'm not worrying about my children, nobody else, because I know what God said. And I'm going to keep praying until the shackles fall, until the chains drop, till they walk out the cage. They might have to walk out of two cages. Peter was in two wars. They may have to walk out of one cage. Don't stop praying because they're in one cage, because they might have a second cage. Keep on praying till they go through the second cage. Yes, the lawyer said something. The judge said something that's impossible. But they kept praying, and Peter kept walking. And Peter kept walking. The impossibility just opened by itself. How many know that your prayers will open impossible doors, will open things that judges and lawyers won't understand why they are changing their mind? A prison break, a prison break. Tell somebody, we already broke out. Now let's go get somebody else and break them out. We already broke out. Tell somebody, I broke out. I'm going to get somebody else who's still in prison. Let's go break them out, Elder. Let's go break them out, brother. Let's go break them out, Tiga. I want you to touch three people and tell them, let's break them out. Let's break them out. Let's go break them out. Let's go break them out. Let's go break them out. How you going to break them out? You're going to get on your knees. You're going to talk to the God. You're going to talk to Jesus. Let's break them out. Everybody stand. If you're in this place today, we ain't gonna waste no time. If you know you hadn't been down, in the name of Jesus, you know that you're still in the bondage of some type of sin, you ain't gotta tell us. We praying for your prison break. We'll take you down in water 24 hours, 7 days a week. If you want the Holy Spirit and you're not fear, spirit filled. Somebody pray for you. These ministers, these missionaries, these prayer warriors. Call them on the phone. You know, people were spirit filled on the phone when there was a pandemic and quarantine. How many know the Spirit don't necessarily need your hand? He needs your heart engulfed in the desire to see somebody pray. If there's any sick among you, call for the elders of the church. I want them the elders today. I want you to real quick just lay hands on them. See, I don't know about, we still believe the word of God. Church still is about the will of God, the word of God. Just tell them real quick, just let them lay hands on you. Just pray. Keep on coming. That's one thing that I learned from this account of Peter. You don't stop praying because you don't see Peter. Because This deliverance is a process. And your prayer is just nudging heaven on. Just nudging heaven on to keep the process going. Oh, God, I praise you. Father, in the name of Jesus, lay hands. The power of your prayer. The power of your joy. The power of your focus, God. Stand for your God. Do it for your glory. I pray right now. Revive and finish. Renew. Oh, God, give them a fresh refilling. A fresh replenishment. A fresh touch of the Holy Ghost. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Father, in the name of Jesus, and in the word we say, Lord, we keep thanking you. We're going to keep I'm talking about walking in victory here. No, you don't see Peter coming through the door, but Peter is on the way. That's why you don't stop praying. He got to get through the chains. He got to get through the shackles. He got to get through the cages. He got to get through the toxicity. Bullies and bullets. Guns and metal detectors. We're gonna pray until the metal detectors have to leave the classroom. We're gonna pray until the bullies leave the classroom. We're gonna pray until those with the bullets trying to destroy our children drop the bullets and deliver from the hell that's got them in bondage. We're gonna pray for a prison break so that our children can focus on learning. Our children don't have to worry in the classroom. Zoe, I'm praying for a prison break. I'm praying as you walk the halls of the school that somebody will see the God in you. Let's pray for a prison break. Let's pray unto saved principals, saved vice principals begin to walk the hall. Thank God for Deacon Barnes. A saved principal walking the hall. A saved principal. But let's not stop praying with him. Let's keep praying unto every school in Mecklenburg County. Every school in Gaston County is filled with saved folk. And let's keep praying. Let's keep praying. God, we acknowledge you in all our ways. Keep praying. Don't worry about nothing. Pray about everything. I don't care who's trying to get in front of you. I don't care who's trying to block you. If God be for you, if God be for you, it's not your ability. It's going to be the power. I'm going to pray until the coaches realize what they got. I'm going to pray until the shadow realizes. I'm going to pray until the colleges offer up the scholarship. And all of the God. Oh, God, I'm praying. Brethren, pray. Hallelujah. Come on, baby. Because of your faith. Hallelujah.
He's incredible.
Father, in the name of Jesus. Look where he brought me from. We're going to pray.
God bless you, everyone. Let us stand as we prepare ourselves to be dismissed in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's time for a breakout. Hallelujah. Look at your neighbor and say, break out. Oh, bless the name of the Lord. Now, look, before we leave, our pastor is going to be doing another book signing. So please take opportunity, amen, and be blessed. Get your book signed, amen, read it, and be blessed, amen. Praise the Lord. Another book signing right after service is in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the matchless name, Lord Jesus Christ. Come on and give God the praise.